This is the operating system's final exam review. This exam, the format of the exam is there's going to be 20 multiple choice questions. Excuse me, 50 multiple choice questions, sorry. And it'll be a 2-hour exam. It is scheduled per the university schedule for final exams on Wednesday, December 18th from 1 to 3 p.m. in JBHT 239. This will be a comprehensive exam, so every topic is going to be covered. Everything from the very beginning of the class until the very end of the class. This exam is closed book, closed notes, and an open mind. Make sure you bring a pencil and a calculator. There are some calculations that you'll want to do on a calculator. There are no laptops permitted, so make sure you bring that calculator. I don't bring calculators to the exam, and I supply them. All right, here are the topics that we covered this semester. First of all, in Module 1, we had the operating systems overview. This covered chapters 1 and 2. And notice that also in the parentheses, I've put the distribution of how much time we spent on each one of the modules. 4 out of the 42 class periods were spent in this particular module. Then the second module was on processes, threads, and CPU scheduling. It's one of the core components of this class, so make sure that you've put a lot of focus on this, on Module 2. And then on process synchronization and deadlocks, process synchronization is a very important part of this class, and it's a natural extension of Module 2 and Module 3. Memory management, this covers, this is from Chapter 8 and 9. There are, well, there's quite a bit of material in this part of it also. Paging, virtual memory, those type of things. That's the focus of that particular module. And then Module 5 is on storage management. You can see that what I did is I picked what I considered important information out of chapters 10, 11, and 12. I only spent 4 class periods on it. This is material that I think the most, I picked the most important things out of them. And I do think that some of this material is important. But it's things that you can read about or pick up later. All right, so let's talk about Module 1. Looking at the objectives, Module 1, you should know the organization of a computer system. We talked a little bit about some different architectures. Hopefully you can describe what a distributed system is. We talked some about special purpose systems, especially in an operating system. Whether it's a real-time operating system, or if it's a workstation, or a large computer of some sort. Lots of different computing environments that we talked about. We talked a little bit about open source, and also the structure of a typical operating system. These are the lessons that mimic the objectives. You can see that we talked distributed systems, special purpose, computing environments, open source, and then the operating system structure. I think it's important to look at some of these topics. I went through and made a list of all the topics out of Module 1, things that will key your memory on things you should know. And if you don't know any of these keywords, then you definitely would want to go back and look at it. You know what an operating system is. We talked about operating system goals and the four components of an operating system. You definitely want to know what the definition of a kernel is. May ask you a question on about bits, bits and bytes, words, kilobyte, megabyte, gigabyte, terabyte, petabyte, exabyte, all those type of things. What bootstrap program is. Definitely know what an interrupt is. We talked about direct memory access so that we could offload the transfer directly to memory without involving the CPU. We talked some about caching. Understand about multiprocessor. Make sure you understand what the acronym SMP stands for. We talked about dual core, quad core type of computers today as far as the architecture. The idea of multi-programming, having lots of programs in memory, ready to go and running so that we can keep the CPU busy. This is an important concept. Also, there's the idea of multitasking, switching, having lots of programs running and being able to switch between them so that you can keep the CPU busy and also make your users happy. We talked quite a bit about user mode versus kernel mode, that the operating system has these two modes of operation to protect itself from accidental or malicious type of activities. Know what a program counter is. Know about security versus protection. Know about distributed systems. We talked a little bit about real-time embedded systems and those special requirements for operating systems. Definitely understand what a client-server type of program, how that operates, and also web-based applications. All right, and then on to Module 2, looking at the objectives of this. This is where a lot of the material, Module 2 and 3, a lot of the material for the test will come from, but not all. Know the definition of what a process is. I would hope you'd be able to list the states of a process. I know that's all the way back in the beginning. Go back and look over that material. Know what a process control block is. Know the difference between a job and a ready queue and those type of things. Understand what a context switch is, how we try to minimize them. But also we need to do some of them in order to do the multitasking and the multi-programming. You should definitely know about the whole idea of processes in Unix or Linux, such as a parent, the child of them, a process identifier. What does PS, that command in Unix, mean? What does forking a program mean and executing the exec program? Definitely understand that we have two different major ways of doing inter-process communication. First of all, we can do shared memory. This tends to be fast. Then the idea of doing message passing, inter-process communication, may be a little bit easier to program, but tends to be slower. We talked about socket, client-server communication. So make sure you understand what socket programming is. We described remote procedure control calls, RPCs. We introduced the idea of what a thread is, a thread of operation. Definitely understand what a thread is. If you don't know what a thread is, then that's something key you should know in any operating systems. And also we talked about some of the different CPU scheduling algorithms. Here's the lessons that sort of mimic. Notice that we, in the second to last lesson, was on pointers to remind yourself what a pointer is in C, because that helps you do the pthread programming. All right, a lot of topics in Module 2. Talked about a process, the diagram of process states. We talked about threads. We talked about schedulers, the idea of a thread or a process being I/O bound versus CPU bound, what a context switch is, the idea of fork, where you make a copy of the process termination. Definitely inter-process communication, message passing versus shared memory. And then we started talking about some of the introducing the idea of synchronization with the producer consumer, a bounded buffer. The idea of synchronization, that if we don't do it right, we can get out of sync. Buffering, client server, sockets and ports, RPC, remote method of invocation. Definitely know all these terms. We talked some about threads and the benefits of threads, quite a bit about threads. And then we talked about concurrency, the idea of having multiple threads or processes that are keep making progress towards some end goal. Amdahl's law, this is make sure you know how to do that calculation. How if a certain percentage of your process can be parallelized versus the other part that's serial, what's a bound on the speed up of the compute time that it requires to do some kind of calculation. Definitely understand pthreads. I may provide some pseudocode or something, some questions about that. The idea of thread pools, going ahead and making a whole bunch of threads available for the end user. Let's see, scheduling. And then in scheduling, we talked about shortest job first, round robin, lots of other different ones. We talked about process affinity. We want the process to sort of hang or stay with a particular CPU so that when we do the context switch back, we have the, and the caches are not out of sync, the cache coherency. Talked about soft affinity, where we try to do that, keep a process with a particular processor, versus hard affinity, where you guarantee that it will happen. If you have multiple processors, you have the idea that if one gets too big, had too much processing, you can push migration, you can push other processes to another CPU, or maybe a CPU will pull migration, in other words, pull processes to it. Hopefully you know the term NUMA, non-uniform memory access. I definitely know about pointers and definitely know about pthreads, because that's how some of the programs that we did in the class. All right, moving on to Module 3. This is the focus of this is a lot more on the synchronization and how we handle it. We talked about race conditions, about, you know, depending on how the scheduler schedules things, and if you don't program your threads correctly and synchronize, you can get different answers, which is not a good thing. We talked about this idea of identifying the most important part of your program, a critical section of a program. So they call that the critical section, and so that when you do any kind of updates in the critical section, you lock all the other processes or threads out so that you can do the updates, and so you don't have race conditions. We talked about the pseudocode for the appropriate synchronization hardware. Talked about semaphores and mutexes, an important concept. We defined deadlock, know the difference between deadlock and starvation. We analyzed solutions to synchronization problems. You should know the difference between a normal semaphore and a semaphore that's within a monitor, and know what a monitor is. Definitely understand the four necessary conditions or be able to list them for deadlock. Know the difference between deadlock prevention and deadlock avoidance. And also on the banker's algorithm, I definitely, you know, I had you do that on the homework, and I may ask you a question on the test, but I don't think I would give you a full-fledged banker's algorithm on the test. That's not, it take a lot of time. It's a very tedious algorithm to do. May ask you parts of it, given some of the information. Here are the lessons that mimic the objectives. Race conditions, critical section, semaphores, monitors, the necessary conditions for deadlock. And then here are the topics. So definitely know what a race condition is. Understand about the critical section. Know that about mutual exclusion, where you have some process or thread that can only access a certain part of a do some updates at a particular time and nobody else will interfere. That you have to make progress. The idea of bounded waiting. You have to have, when you do these synchronization problems, you have to have some limit on how long a process or thread will have to wait. Look at Peterson's algorithm. It was one of the first synchronization algorithms, so look at it. We talked about these hardware-based primitives that are provided by computer architecture people, things like lock, test and set, swap. Semaphores, know what a semaphore is. Know what a mutex is, which is nothing more than just a binary semaphore. Spin lock, busy waiting. The idea that a process or a thread could block itself. Know what deadlock is, starvation, Priority inversion. This is when a lower level process has some resource that a higher level priority process or a thread has. And so, in effect, the lower level process has preempted or actually made itself a higher priority than the higher level priority because it's holding some resource. So definitely understand what that is. Look at the bounded buffer problem, very common problem. The reader's writer's problem, we talked about reader's first, reader's second problem. Definitely look at the dining philosopher's problem. I'm going to ask you a question on it most likely. Understand what a monitor is. That way, you know, a monitor is where you can list all the different functions or methods, whichever way you want to look at it, within the monitor, and the monitor will guarantee that only one of them will be running at the same time. The idea of doing a wait and a signal with semaphores. Definitely know the deadlock necessary conditions. We talked some about resource allocation graphs, deadlock prevention, and then there's deadlock avoidance. We talked the idea about of a safe state, so that safe states, we can define them such that you know you will not get into deadlock if you're in a safe state. Now, that's not to say, though, if you're in an unsafe state, doesn't mean you necessarily will get into deadlock, but you could. And then finally, the banker's algorithm. Definitely look over it. All right, module 4. The objectives of it, the idea of having dynamic linking and shared libraries. We talked about swapping. Know the difference between external and internal fragmentation. Definitely understand how to implement paging using the TLB, transaction look-aside buffer. Knowing what a TLB is considered an important concept. We analyze the performance of a paging system, so definitely understand paging and page faults and all the different ways that we handle doing paging. I probably will ask you a small design question on how to do a paging system. We talked about doing segmentation. Also, then we had this idea of virtual memory, where our memory that we can address is actually larger than the physical memory. And so we can write the different pages off to some, typically a hard disk or other media. Definitely understand what demand paging is. I consider that a core thing to know in out of operating systems. And also analyze and design a demand paging system. So as you get to some information that you need, you cause a page fault. You go and grab that off the disk, load it into memory, and then you're running again. So even though there's only 4 lessons, there's a lot of material in this section. Swapping, contiguous memory, paging, segmentation, and virtual memory. These are important concepts. All right, here is a list of topics for Module 4. You know, base and limit registers, address binding, logical and physical addresses, memory management unit, relocation registers, swapping, dynamic linking, contiguous allocation, external versus internal fragmentation, know what segmentation is, what paging is, what a TLB is, effective access time, how we handle shared pages. We talked a little bit about hashed two-level paging. Understand that. We also said that you could do a page table for looking up pages with a hash table. You can actually do an inverted page table. That's sort of strange. Look at it. Virtual memory, and then doing shared libraries with virtual memory, demand paging, what page faults are, demand paging performance. Recall that I gave you a question and looked at a few loops, and you had to determine how many page faults there were. We talked about page replacement algorithms, first in, first out, optimum, least recently used, I guess it's Belides anomaly, where you actually may increase the number of pages in the physical memory that are available, but actually he may, strangely enough, create more page faults. And then also thrashing, where you're doing more page faults than actual computation. You know what that is. Okay, let's see. On to Module 5. Module 5 was a little bit short, a short module. It covers, I think, three different chapters. So we talked, it's a lot of things that a lot of students understand, but I wanted to hit some of the high points of it. Some things that you may have heard the term but really didn't understand. So definitely understand about a file system and how an operating system pretty much has control of it. How in the world you access remote files across local area networks. Understand I'll probably have you identify the components of a hard disk drive. You should be able to label or the components, or actually be able to identify them if I tell you what part if I describe one of the parts of a hard disk. RAID, so RAID 0, RAID 1, 2, all of these things. I will ask you a question about RAID, the idea of having these inexpensive disk drives. So definitely understand what RAID is and these definitions of the different types of RAID. So we had two main lessons on it, file system implementation and the mass storage structure. Here are some of the topics from Module 5. Like I said, it's sort of a small section, but there will be a handful of problems on there. I imagine 3 to 5, I don't know, something like that. File structures, file attributes, file operations, disk structure, partitioning. Know what partitioning means. Know what mounting is, network file system, file control block, contiguous allocation. Some of the disk mechanisms, track, sector, cylinder, platter, ARM, what do all these things mean? Know the definition of a network attached storage, also a storage area network. We briefly talked some about the disk scheduling, which mimics the CPU scheduling. First come, first serve, shortest seek time first, scan, and circular scan, so you might want to look up those terms. Boot code, the swap space manager, and then finally RAID. So these are the topics for Module 5. And I think that is the end of it. As a general, description of this, make sure that you look over all the material. I will ask questions over all the material, but it is a lot of material, and I understand that. But if you look at the distribution of the different modules, I'm going to mimic approximately the number of questions that I ask on each one of those. So make sure that you study and get a good night's sleep and come ready to answer the questions. Even though it is multiple choice, don't let that stop you from studying. It will be a challenging test.